Good morning. It's 6 a.m. at Facebook headquarters and 9 a.m. from the floor of the New York Stock Exchange. This is Sara Sleeveless reporting live for CNBC. It's August 20th, 2020, and this is today's news. In his daily pandemic briefing this morning, Dr. Fauci reported that the CDC still has no explanation why the COVID-19 death rate among skinny, white, wealthy people is double that of poor people of color. Dr. Fauci once again urges our most vulnerable, middle-aged white men in positions of influence to continue taking all possible precautions, including social distancing and masking. In one sign of hope, Jeff Bezos, whose company Amazon stock is now down almost 60% since the start of the pandemic, announced that its Prime vaccine service is rolling out nationwide. Starting at midnight, Prime members simply need to say, "Alexa, schedule my vaccination," and they will be prompted to select the most convenient time for their at-home inoculation. Walmart has also announced the vaccine will be available at pop-up vaccination super facilities located in the parking lots of their 4,800 stores across the U.S. The Bentonville firm's click-and-collect infrastructure is being converted to click-and-vaccinate stations. In a show of solidarity to the effort, Uber is offering free rides to anyone who needs transportation to a Walmart vaccine site. Another pandemic-related news, Apple and Google held a joint virtual press conference earlier today to announce that their contact tracing app has been downloaded over 1 billion times worldwide. In a press release issued earlier today, Apple CEO Tim Cook reiterated their commitment to contact tracing efforts. Cook said, "While privacy is a human right, care for one another is what makes us human." Finally, Facebook and Twitter report they have eliminated all anti-vax content on their platforms. A Facebook spokesperson also noted that the realignment of its algorithm to the promotion of scientifically proven facts has already seen trust in the vaccine across Republicans rise from 32% to 68% of users in 1 week. The NASDAQ was up almost 0.5% on these developments, but is yet to reverse its 35% decline since the pandemic began. Does that sound like a fantasy? Consider this. What if the pandemic had crushed big tech stocks instead of sending them soaring? What if the virus had been more fatal to white and wealthy people than to people of color? Would we be approaching 500,000 deaths? Or might we have undertaken the type of response we've seen during other crises? Put another way, to inspire a full-throated capitalist response, didn't we first need a destruction in capital? Aren't the people in charge living their best lives? More innovation and less inattention. Isn't that what we needed? Instead, what did we get? The Great Grift. By the way, when you see me, you might think, well, he's intelligent, maybe sort of interesting, but definitely not very good looking. However, after seeing me as a woman, how do you like me now? Anyway, the federal government's $5 trillion response to the COVID pandemic has been unprecedented for all the wrong reasons and shifted the question from how the government can help to who is the government actually helping. Of the $5 trillion spent so far, only around $1.5 trillion came in the form of direct aid to individuals, and that money was well spent. However, only 15% of recipients who received first-round stimulus checks said they intended to spend the money. Let that sink in. More than 4 in 5 recipients of government money did not urgently need that money. Another $1 trillion of the $5 trillion went to the pandemic response. The remaining $2.5 trillion was allocated as mostly forgivable loans and direct handouts to businesses. To sum up, $5 trillion spent with roughly $1 trillion in direct aid to individuals, $1 trillion to the actual pandemic response, and a $3 trillion wealth transfer to the shareholder class. To fund the stimulus, we've borrowed trillions and taken on debt levels not seen since World War II. Young people and their children will be paying off the debts of the Great Grift for decades. And the younger you are, the more you've been grifted. This continues a long trend. In 1989, people under the age of 40 commanded 13% of wealth in the U.S. In 2020, that number's declined to 6%. That's right. The wealth of people under the age of 40 has been halved in the last 30 years. In December, 18% of U.S. households with children were food insecure, and 26% of renters with children were behind on their rent. Our most vulnerable are struggling, and instead of lending them a hand, we've bolstered the stock portfolios of the wealthy. We have lost the script. Instead of $3 trillion in handouts to the wealthiest Americans, we could have given $30,000 to every American who reported pandemic-related wage losses in 2020. And you know the craziest thing about giving money to people who actually need it? They spend it. It ends up going back into the economy versus the market. So how did we get here? How did we go from protecting people to protecting business? Simple. We sat back and let private capital overrun the government. It's a government for the rich, by the rich. America used to be about making people rich. Now America is about keeping the wealthy rich. This cronyism isn't new. Capital has been overrunning labor for decades. And in no place is this more obvious than the U.S. tax code. In the U.S., capital gains, that is the money you make from selling stock or other assets, is taxed at a maximum of 20%, while the federal tax rate for wages, that is money people actually work hard for and earn, is taxed at up to 37%. Let me reiterate that. Income gained from selling stock in a firm is taxed at a lower rate than income gained from actually working at that firm. This makes no sense. Another example of how our system transfers money from the poor to the wealthy: a homeowner can deduct mortgage interest on a first and second home, while those who can't afford to buy pay non-taxable deductible rent. These tax advantages are pitched to the American public as a formula for how to get wealthy, when in reality, it's a formula for how to stay wealthy. The result is that since 1989, the wealthiest 1% of American households have increased their share of the nation's wealth by a third, while the bottom 50% have seen their share halved. And that was before the pandemic. The U.S. once waged a war on poverty. Now we wage a proxy war on the poor. And we are in desperate need for a course correction. We need to end unnecessary business bailouts and a tax code that favors the rich. An even better idea? A one-time wealth tax, a 2% tax on the wealthiest 5% of households. That one-time tax would raise up to $1 trillion. Elon Musk is now worth almost $200 billion. That's roughly the GDP of Belize, Guatemala, El Salvador, Honduras, Nicaragua, and Costa Rica combined. Before the pandemic, he was worth a modest $30 billion. So a 2% wealth tax would cost him $4 billion, leaving him just $196 billion, up $166 billion from just 12 months ago. If a wealth tax has any chance of happening, we need to reduce the influence of money on politics. The 400 wealthiest families provide roughly half the funding for the presidential campaign, and they speedball this money with PACs, think tanks, and media, again, owned by a small number of families. They expect and get payback. We need more transparency from our elected representatives, who they meet with, and how much that person paid for that privilege. Finally, if we don't align financial reward and penalties with the health of our commonwealth, we are doomed to a pattern of failed responses to crises. We cannot have a sustainable economy and political system where we outsource war, debt, disease, and suffering to the poor, the young, and the unborn. We are the wealthiest nation in the world. We like to think we're the most generous people in the world. Let's start acting like it. P.S. We are not a nation broken, just unfinished. We'll see you next week. God, I'm in menopause. I'm so hot in this thing. Yeah, that sounded funny or wrong. All right, so I take off my wig here for dramatic effect. Whew, whew, whew. Hot in there.